chance. Highs in the lower 20s today. Fair with lows tonight of 5 to 15. A little bit warmer Wednesday. Highs in the upper 20s or the lower 30s, perhaps. It's about 8 above zero at both of the airports, which is 13 degrees below zero Celsius. 12 at the lakefront presently. That's 11 below on the Celsius scale. Westerly winds 9 miles. The humidity is 63%. If you're driving your car right now, I've got a revelation for you. You're off balance. That's because your car isn't balanced. If it were, it would handle better, steer and corner more precisely. So how do you balance your car? The truth is, you can't. The only way to drive a balanced car is to drive Alfeda from Alfa Romeo. Alfeda is the world's first and truly balanced production car. It's available at Loeber Motors, 1111 North Clark Street in Chicago. Half its weight is in front and half is in back. A totally new experience in driving. One with more stability, more confidence in cornering, and more control than you ever thought possible. But Alfeda is more than balance. It's superb comfort and safety, too. With four-wheel disc brakes, protected passenger compartment, quick-acting rack and pinion steering. Yet with all of these features, Alfeda costs under $7,500. Come see the remarkable Alfeda today. It's at Loeber Motors in Chicago at 1111 North Clark Street. Alfeda from Alfa Romeo, four-time world champion. It caught the car world off balance. You're listening to WXFM Elmwood Park in Chicago, broadcasting from Sears Tower, WXFM Stereo 106, 30 seconds after 7 o'clock.
Don't touch that dial. The night is gone. The morning's here. It's a beautiful day in Chicago. And this is Chuck Shaden inviting you to spend a part of it with us in the hall closet. The sounds of good old radio entertainment coming right up.
The Tom McRalston Straight Shooters.
The Guiding Light. Can you top this?
Tom Corbett. Space Cadet.
Henry. Henry Aldrich.
Coming, Mother.
True Detective Mysteries.
The Charlie McCarthy Show.
Good morning, Mom, and hello out there in Radio Land. This is Chuck Shaden in the hall closet for Tuesday morning, February 1st, 1977, a brand new month for some more good old radio listening, and we have a closet filled with lots of good sounds for you today. Today we're going to begin an 18-part series called The Glenn Miller Story, a 1958 broadcast, taking a great, good, in-depth look at the music and the man, Glenn Miller. We'll also have an Amos and Andy broadcast from 1945, and we're going to begin things with a Bing Crosby show from March 9th of 1949. On this show, Bing's guests are Phil Harris and Elliot Lewis, Phil Harris and Frankie Remley, if you will. Peggy Lee pops up a little later on. This is a very good show. It's really a lot of fun, and it's going to brighten your Tuesday morning. From March 9th of 1949, the Bing Crosby show.
When the blue meet the goal of the day, someone waits for me.
This is Ben Carpenter welcoming you to Fillmore Radio Time, produced and transcribed in the Marine Memorial Auditorium in San Francisco. The soundtrack product is orchestra. Judge Conlon for the mayor's and Bing's guests. Bing's guests? Say, Bing, you got the late pink. Who are our guests tonight?
Who?
Yeah.
Why, Ken, I distinctly heard you say that our guests would be Jack Teagarden last week. You said Jack Teagarden, Joe Vanuti, and Louis Armstrong. What happened to our big scheduled New Orleans jazz soiree?
Well, I don't know, but they're just not here, Bing.
Well, holy jumped up Toledo. Riverboat must have hit a mud bank somewhere near Hannibal, Missouri or something.
Don't worry, Bing. Armstrong, Teagarden, Vanuti, and the whole mob will be with us next week.
Next week? Well, the joint will definitely be pitching and tossing then, I'm sure of that.
Just be a shambles, I know.
But meanwhile,
what are we going to do tonight?
We are facing a contretemps.
We are.
Mm. I don't know about you, Ken, but I'm ducking over to Arthur Murray's for a dancing lesson. My samba has gone into a slump. I'm not getting any business at all.
That's not all.
Not too loud.
Oh, no, no, Bing. You can't leave. You can't go from here. We've got to stay here and be troopers.
I see. The show must go on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the first one in the audience to holler why gets $8 and a box of Snickers. What?
Give that lady $8.
You've been to too many quiz programs.
Well, Bing, this is serious. What are we going to do?
Well, somebody's bound to drop in and help us tonight, Ken. Our agents are out scouring the town at this very moment, armed with guns, nets, and money. Meanwhile, while they're out, if John Scott has a new picture out called Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court, the Rhythm Ayers and I are going to sing the tunes from this Technicolor extravaganza for the first time on the air. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the brighter numbers from Connecticut Yankee. Title, Busy Doing Nothing is the title. John?
La, 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 la. To find lots of things not to do. We're busy going nowhere. Isn't it just a crime? We'd like to be unhappy, but we never do have the time. I have to watch the river to see that it doesn't stop, and stick around the rosebuds so they'll know when to pop.
You must rehearse the songbirds to see that they sing in key.
Hustle, bustle, and never a moment free. Doing nothing, working the whole day through, trying to find lots of things not to do. We're busy going nowhere, now isn't it just a crime? We'd like to be unhappy, but we never do have.
We never do have.
We never do, never do, never do, never do, never do, never do have.
Well, Bing and boys and girls.
Oh, you're kind, Ken.
I know it. Bing, I'm still worried about not having any guests tonight.
What do you mean, no guests? Look yonder there. Isn't that Peggy Lee?
Well, it certainly is.
And I'll bet this is only the beginning. Hiya, Peg. What brings you here?
Well, I was standing in the lobby of the St. Francis, and a fellow stuck a gun in my ribs and threw a net over me and handed me a $5 bill, and here I am.
And they're glad to see you. As well they might be. You see, Ken, you see what I told you? I knew our boys had snagged some people. You can take the net off now, Peg. Say, Peg, a few weeks ago we did a duet on that fine Cole Porter tune, So in Love. You want to do it again now?
Well,
you're here and...
Yeah, I got my $5.
Certainly, you
better
say
something.
You got it.
Pardon me, Bing, but before you and Peggy sing, I think I should remind the folks that there's still big bargains at our Philco dealers.
Oh, yes, in case anyone doesn't know about those fine Philco values, let them know immediately, Ken.
Oh, you're so right, Bing. And our Philco dealers have got just what it takes. But don't look for guns or nets, folks. Our dealers are scouring the town with money. If you want to make friends with $25.65, see your Philco dealer fast while he's still featuring the hottest radio phonograph offer of the year. Now, just try this for size. With your purchase of a new two-speed Philco radio phonograph console, your dealer will include at no extra charge a regular library of non-breakable long-playing records, up to 80 different selections, including 8 complete Crosby classics. Man, that's money in your pocket. A clear cash saving of up to $25.65 on the most sensational combination in recorded music. But you better get a move on. This wonderful offer is almost over. Now is your last chance to set yourself up with the finest of radio phonograph consoles at a friendship-making saving of as much as $25.65. Don't miss these once-in-a-blue-moon values from Philco, the leader.
Mm-hmm.
stars fill the sky. So in love with you am I.
Even without you, my arms fall about you.
Belief for this wild story. I would be mad to expect it, yet mad I'm not, and very surely I do not dream, but while there is still time, I don't know why, I feel compelled to report a series of mere household events and their consequences. These events have terrified, have tortured, have destroyed me. Perhaps some are more calm, more logical, but certainly far less excitable than I will be able to explain them. I cannot. I can only tell you the facts, and that I have to do today because tomorrow I die.
That's Peter Lorre on our cassette tape of the month for February. Peter Lorre stars in the 1947 Mystery in the Air broadcast of Edgar Allan Poe's classic The Black Cat. And Bela Lugosi stars in an exciting suspense drama from 1943 entitled The Doctor Prescribed Death. Two exciting mystery dramas this month on a single hour-long cassette tape for only $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. Bela Lugosi plays a psychologist who tries to transfer suicide to murder, and Peter Lorre is driven to madness and murder by the evils of drink. An hour's worth of great thrills and chills this month on our February cassette tape of the month. $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. Or you can get your February tape at any of the five offices of Northwest Federal Savings, or when you visit our Metro Golden Memory Shop at 5120 West Irving Park Road. Bela Lugosi in The Doctor Prescribed Death on Suspense, Peter Lorre in Edgar Allan Poe's The Black Cat on Mystery in the Air. $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. Our cassette tape of the month for February.
Bing, I was just out in the hall. You got an extra net around here?
Oh, we haven't even used the big net yet.
No. Well, if you can use it, I think I can snag a couple of extra guests for our show tonight.
Good. Who you got out there in the hall, Ken?
Phil Harris and his guitar player, Frank Remley.
Phil?
Yeah.
Phil.
Good
back to the Lawton and Harris.
Well,
I'm surprised to hear this. I didn't know they're out in the hall. I thought Phil fired old Frankie.
Well, he did, but Phil's been taking Frankie around a lot of other programs trying to get him a job.
Oh, he finally got down to us, huh?
Yeah.
I wonder what they're cooking up out there.
I keep telling you, Frankie, I got to get you a job. Don't you see, living under our roof, eating our food, wearing my clothes, taking cigarette money from Alice? You're going to lose your self-respect. It's only going to hurt you.
Don't worry about it, Curly. I can take it.
That's the trouble. You can take it faster than me and Alice can make it.
This don't sound like you, Curly. Has Alice been picking on me again?
Well, do you blame her? Alice didn't mind feeding you or clothing you, but... Well, like that day you went to the racetrack, that really burned her up.
Well, a guy goes nuts not working. I had to have some recreation.
I know, Frankie, but borrowing money on our furniture.
All right, I was wrong, but did Alice have to carry on so?
Well, women are funny, you know that.
Yeah.
When she heard about it, she started to cry and ran upstairs and threw herself on the bed. That's when she really got mad.
Why?
The bed wasn't there. Can't you understand, Remley? It's not that we don't love you or we don't like having you for a house guest, but now you've moved in permanently.
Well, you and Alice always wanted a son.
Look, Junior, we want the kind that plays "This Little Piggy Went to Market," not "This Little Pony Went to the Post."
All right, all right.
When I talk about wanting a son, I mean a little baby I can play with. Someone I can pick up off the floor and teach how to walk.
Well, we've only tried that a few times, Curly. Give me another chance.
I keep telling you it ain't gonna work. Now, look, Alice says if you come home with me one time again, she leaves. So it's either you or Alice. And naturally, you know the decision I have to make.
But don't worry about it. I know dames. Alice will come crawling back to us on our hands and knees.
Look, you got to get a job of your own. I keep trying to tell you I'm sick and tired of you depending on me.
What do you mean depending on you? I've been out working. How about them shoelaces? Didn't I go selling shoelaces from door to door?
Yeah, you went from my front door to my back door.
Well, that's door to door.
And big-hearted me. I get stuck with a pair of orange shoelaces.
Well, they look pretty, don't they?
On blue shoes? Them ain't even my school colors. Look, I'm going to get you some work. Now, look, I'm going in to talk to Bing, but I want to talk to Bing alone first. Now,
okay.
Wait out here, and I'll
right.
talk to him.
All right.
I'll see if I can break the ice.
Well, I'll see if I can get some white rock.
I didn't mean that. Now, wait out here. Hey, Bingo.
Oh, hello, Phil.
Hiya, Bing. Long time no see.
I guess it's been 15 years.
Since we've seen each other?
No, since I heard that jazzy greeting. Long time no see.
You like it, take it. You might get credit for starting it again.
You got it.
Hey, Bing, I realize we don't get together very often, but I listen to your program all the time. You're the tops.
Thanks.
How about me on my program?
I lost you. Are you the fellow that's still over on that network? I can't... can't find... What's on your mind, Phil? What's...
Well, look, Bing, I don't want to beat around the bush. I'm busy, and you've got
yeah.
money. Look,
What?
I came here to see about getting a job for Frank Remley. You remember Frank, my guitar player?
What are you doing out trying to get a job for Frank Remley, the guitar? You his agent or something?
No, it ain't that thing. It's just that, well, I feel responsible for the guy. I picked him up from the gutter and put him up in my band.
Phil, from the gutter to your band is not up.
What do you mean?
No, I'm kidding. I'm just kidding.
Well, kidding. Yeah. This ain't no time to kid.
Well,
I'm a kid. What's kidding? I don't want no kidding routine. I'm 100 years old. I come here to talk business. Lucky to get out of the house. I mean, you make a crack about my band, I'll back it up. What's wrong with my
well,
band?
Well, for one thing, Phil, if they ever start to count noses at Alcatraz, I know three guys you're going to lose like that.
That's a nasty remark. Why don't you leave them guys alone? They're out on probation.
No. You mean probation. Prohibition's how they get in.
All right. I don't want to learn a lot of new words. Let's just keep it rolling. What I'm trying to do is, can you find a job for Frankie and that?
Well, I'm always on the lookout for talent.
Don't change the subject. Now, do you want to do something for the kid, or don't you?
Oh, Phil, you've had Frankie around to all the other programs. He was turned down. Now, why do you want to palm him off on a guy like that on me?
Well, it ain't.
But nobody wants him. You wind up with, you trying to sell him to me. What's this?
Ain't nobody
kind
wants
of a hustle
him. It ain't this. That ain't it at all. I mean, let's don't sell the kid short, you know, Bing. The kid's got a lot of talent.
Well, maybe.
Other than playing. Look, give him a chance, Bing. The guy's changed a lot. Being out of work has mellowed him. He's industrious. He's serious. Well, look, you can see for yourself. He's right out here. Hey, Frankie. There he is now. Hey, Frankie. I want you to meet Bing Crosby.
Never mind him, Curly. Pipe the blonde.
Frankie.
Hiya, honey. What's your name?
Peggy Lee.
Look, Frankie, this is Bing over here, the one in the smock. You got the wrong one.
Take it easy, Clyde. What are you doing around here, honey?
Well, I work here.
Frankie, will you break it up? I'm trying to get you some work.
I don't need work. My girl's got a job.
Listen, Frankie, you don't just go out and grab some blonde because she happens to have a good job.
Look who's talking. Phil tells me you had a lot of discouragement lately trying to find work, huh?
Oh, yeah, I got turned down all over town. In fact, last night I happened to walk into the Brown Derby and there was Curly drowning my sorrow.
Me and Frankie sat there a while and finally we hit on the idea of coming to see you now.
Oh, that's why you came up here to San Francisco?
San Francisco? Are we in San Francisco?
Wow! As long as we're up this way, Bing, look, how about giving the boy San Francisco?
Hey.
How about giving him a chance?
Well, Phil, if Frankie's looking for a job as my accompanist, I guess we can give him a little audition. Ought to be in order, huh?
No, that won't be necessary. I heard you sing.
Frankie, he wants to know if you're any good. He's sold on himself already.
Well, Curly, you better tell him what a great musician I am. I'll only start laughing.
Well, look, Bing, let me tell you something, Bing. Frankie's a terrific guitar player. Really a great man with a pick.
You don't do too bad with a shovel, either. I'd like to help, Phil, but I got a guitar player. I can't fire Perry Botkin. He's been accompanying me for over 10 years. He knows my every nuance.
Oh, blackmail, huh?
Well, now, I'd give Frankie a chance if I didn't have Perry. If, you know, if for some reason Perry couldn't work because he broke an arm or something, I'd hire Frankie without any question.
You wouldn't even ask how Perry got his arm broke? Look, Curly, every time I get a constructive idea, you discourage me.
Don't get no ideas. So that's final, huh, Bing? You can't use an extra guitar player?
No, there wouldn't be any room for him. I can't see putting a fellow on salary. It'd be completely useless.
Maybe you could make him a brother.
Huh,
Bing?
Well, you just got something there.
Hey, you'll be proud of him, Bing. He's your kind of guy.
Now, wait a minute.
Hey, Frankie, how would you like to leave me and move in with the Crosby?
That's a tough decision to make, Curly. How does that Dixie stack up against Alice?
Frankie, that's no way to talk about ladies. They both stack up good.
Thank you, Phil. Dixie will be thrilled.
You see, Bing, with Frankie, you're not only getting just a guitar player, you know, you're getting a son.
Just what I need.
Yes, sir, that is the deal, huh, Bing?
I don't know, Phil. I'm worried about how Frankie'd fit in with our organization. You see, we have rather a dignified, conservative group. Well, they're well-behaved, and Frankie, you know, he's got a reputation for being a little, shall we say, mischievous, a little high-spirited. Well, you know what I'm, Frank, what I'm trying to arrive at.
I don't even know how I got to San Francisco.
Yeah, you see, that's the whole thing in a nutshell. Phil, if I put Frankie in with my men, it's just the old story. One rotten apple can spoil the whole barrel. However, I'll check with John Scott Trotter.
That's what I like about you, Bing. You go right direct to the barrel. Hi, John.
Hello, Phil.
Say, John, I don't want to take a lot of your time either, but I guess you know what I'm here for. You see, Frankie needs work. Do you want to help him?
I'm always willing to give anyone a chance, Phil. Of course, in my band, all the boys read music.
If I ever catch one of my guys reading while he's supposed to be working, out he goes.
Hey, Phil, why don't you let Frankie speak for himself?
Yeah, Curly. What is it you want to know, Mr. Trotter?
Can you read music?
Fluently.
Lay it on him.
All right, I'm not going to put anybody on the spot here. I dislike doing it, but Frankie, here's a sheet of music. Let's see if you can read the first line.
Okay. Two black dots, a circle, four black dots, a circle with a line through it, four black dots.
There you are. Atta boy, Frankie. Amazing. I didn't think you could do it. My hand. Hey.
Now, come on, Curly. I wouldn't be happy here.
Happy? What's wrong with it, dude?
Well, it's too, je ne sais quoi.
Well, then, come on. I don't want you to catch nothing.
Wait a minute. No, here. You can't blow yet. Don't be cutting out. As long as you're here, stand by here for a little preview.
Preview?
Yeah, you see, Paramount has a new picture out soon called Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court. Peggy Lee, the Rhythm Ayers, and I are going to sing the tunes from this Technicolor extravaganza for the first time on the air.
Why?
You see, if we do the songs and the listeners like them, they'll dash to see the picture when it comes out.
Well, what if they don't like the songs?
I'm in the shoelace business.
Hey, Curly, is Crosby broke?
Don't be silly. Got nearly as much money as Alice.
That's pure propaganda.
John?
Rhonda Fleming has got a very nice song in the show. Miss Rhonda Fleming, that is. Sings it, Mrs. Peggy Lee's demonstration, the same song.
There's an article about the George Gershwin 1945 movie Rhapsody in Blue in our nostalgia newsletter and radio guide for the month of February. Also, we have Phil Harris and Alice Faye on the cover, and that's just the first of 32 pages of fun and memories that you will have when you subscribe to our little nostalgia guide. A one-year subscription is $7. You can subscribe right now when you call us at our brand new number, 943-7474. Begin a year's worth of good reading and good entertainment. 943-7474. Give us your name and address. We'll start your subscription with the current February issue. We'll get that out to you right away, and we'll include an invoice along with your first issue. Page after page of photos and memories, plus the complete listing of our old-time radio broadcast schedule. An article about radio's inner sanctum, another about film director Leo McCarey. Carl Pearson notes from the bandstand this month about the Armed Forces Radio V-Disc program during World War II. There's an article about the kids' show Big John and Sparky and the story of radio in 1942 with a primetime log for a given day in 1942. Lots of fun and lots of good memories in our newsletter. It's yours when you call 943-7474. 7-4. A one-year subscription, $7. You can start bridging the time gap right away. Subscribe now, 943-7474. If you like, send $7 to Nostalgia Newsletter, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. But why not make it easy for yourself? Give us a buzz at 943-7474.
Here's another merry tune from Connecticut Yankee, Stub Your Toe on the Moon. John Scott, give me a little downbeat and we'll leap right in.
Just a second, Bing. These new songs are thrilling and beautiful.
Thank you, Ken. Stub Your Toe on the Moon, John.
But, Bing.
What do you want?
Well, it seems fairly obvious, doesn't it, Bub? I got to stub my toe on a Philco commercial here.
Okay, Ken. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish to point out that no matter what Mr. Carpenter says, it has nothing to do with the plot of the picture. There are no Philco radios in King Arthur's court, no Philco refrigerators, no Philco freezers.
Yes, I'm going to speak to the factory about that. The order went in months ago. Gee, just imagine poor King Arthur without a Philco console to his name. Don't let it happen to you, folks. Mount your trusty charger now while the great console tournament is still on at your Philco dealer and carry off your prize with a saving of up to $25.65 on the greatest combination in the history of recorded music. Man, the age of chivalry has returned. Your Philco dealer is giving away the greatest entertainment bargain of the year. While this special offer lasts, you get at no extra charge up to $25.65 worth of new long-playing records, as many as 80 different selections when you buy a new two-speed Philco radio phonograph console. Those dollars saved make it more than ever worthwhile to buy your new Philco console now. See your dealer now for the year's greatest radio phonograph values from Philco, famous for quality the world over.
And here, after a slight but delightful delay, is Stub Your Toe on the Moon. Oh, there's nothing to be ashamed of
if you stub your toe on the moon.
When it dreams at the top of the sky, well, you just have to jump pretty high. But don't give up too soon if you stub your toe on the moon. Now you take Harry Hadgett.
Who's Harry Hadgett?
Big man, young Harry Hadgett. Loves making gadgets. Life needs some new things, was his claim. Hopes one or two things might bring fame. This is the last time you'll hear his name. Nobody mentions Harry's invention. But do you think that got him down?
No.
Here comes the end when you gadgets to mend. He's the best repairman in town. So there's nothing to be ashamed of.
Nothing to be ashamed of.
If you stub your toe on the moon.
Stub your toe on the moon. Though it may be a blow to your pride.
You're a hero because, well, you drive.
So don't give up too soon if you stub your toe on the moon. If you stub your toe on the moon.
The piece has a ballad, which Peggy and I'd like to do for you now. We think it's quite lovely, and we earnestly solicit your approval.
Once and for always, let's have it understood. We will be together.
Let's not wait and hope for something more sublime. Don't you know that our way isn't too much time?
So once and for always, let's say that it's agreed. Days are over. This is tonight we'll notify the stars above
that once and for always
I know lesson always you and I will be
up here. I do hope you folks have enjoyed Johnny Burke and Jimmy Van Heusen's score from Connecticut Yankee. My thanks now to Peggy Lee, Phil Harris, and Elliot Lewis, who plays Frankie, for joining up with us tonight.
Who's with you next week, Bing, or can you follow this one?
We can only try. Just kidding. On the square, we got a mighty mellow jamboree cooked up with Louis Armstrong, Jack Teagarden, Joe Fanuti, Red Nickel, Nick Fatool, Peggy Lee, Perry... Oh, Bodkin, we're really going to fly. We're going to take off. We won't come down for a week or so. Good night, folks, and thank you very much. So long, Phil.
This program was produced and transcribed in San Francisco by Bill Morrow and Myrtle McKenzie. Phil Harris, made to see tune in to Philco Radio Time next week and hear Bing Crosby, John Scott Trotter and his orchestra, Judge Collins with the Mayors, and Bing's guest, Peggy Lee, Louis Armstrong, Jack Teagarden, and Joe Venuti. And remember, keep your eye on your Philco dealer now for the greatest values in radio phonographs from Philco, the leader.
This is Chuck Shaden with the best of good old radio every weekday morning in the Hall Closet on WXFM 106 on your FM dial.
25 before 8 a.m. is the time. Going to be mostly sunny, not quite so cold. We'll have highs in the lower 20s today, fair with lows 5 to 15 tonight. Mostly cloudy on Wednesday, a little bit warmer. High should be in the upper 20s or the lower 30s. And the temperatures around Chicago right now, 7 degrees above zero at the airports, 14 below Celsius. 12 below is the present, or 12 above is the present lakefront temperature, which is minus 11 Celsius. Winds northwesterly 12 miles per hour, and the humidity is approximately 63%.
That was the Bing Crosby Show from March 9th of 1949 with Phil Harris and Frankie Remley. Elliot Lewis as Frankie Remley. Good show, and sound pretty good to share with you this morning in our hall closet. This is Chuck Shaden on WXFM 106 on your FM dial. Hey, we have a new old thing coming up this Saturday. We begin our memory club again. If you have a fondness for the good old days, then you're automatically a member of our memory club. It meets every Saturday evening in the community room at Northwest Federal Savings. That's at 4901 West Irving Park Road in Chicago. We have every Saturday night all year long now, from February through November usually, a good old movie or some kind of a great nostalgic special event. Dues are $1.25 a meeting, payable at the door, and you're automatically a member of our memory club because you're a member of our listening audience. Now, we're kicking things off with a Bing Crosby show. Well, not the one you just heard, but a 1938 motion picture called Sing You Sinners, starring Bing Crosby, Fred McMurray, and Donald O'Connor. And Bing, he plays a gambling gay blade who just can't face responsibilities. And you're going to have a lot of fun facing the music with Bing. He sings I've Got a Pocket Full of Miracles. And then there's, in this film, the memorable Small Fry number featuring Donald O'Connor, who is 13 years old at the time of this film, 1938. Bing Crosby in Sing You Sinners, our first Memory Club movie of the brand new season. this coming Saturday evening in the community room at Northwest Federal Savings. Doors open at 7:30. Our film will begin at 8 o'clock. Lots of free parking in the lot at the rear of the office on Dakin Street, or take CTA transportation to the door. The Memory Club and our first movie, the premiere film of the new season, Sing You Sinners, from 1938. Now, we'll take a short break, then we'll be back with Amos and Andy. Stick around and don't touch that dial.
In 1930 in Corbin, Kentucky, I opened a restaurant, and my regular customers knew me as Harland. Folks farther away, though, called me Colonel Sanders. I had a good business, and lots of customers became my friends and looked forward to coming in. Then a big superhighway was put in, and I had to move on. I was 66 then. Most thought I'd retire. But no siree, not with all of those people out there that had come to know and love my Kentucky Fried Chicken. Why, for years I'd been developing and perfecting my special seasoning of 11 different herbs and spices, blending them together just so they complemented the flavor of my chicken. Why, when I served my Kentucky Fried Chicken dinner with all the fixings, I believed I'd given someone one of the best meals the American table could afford. I think of my Kentucky Fried Chicken dinners as North America's hospitality dish, and I hope that you'll help yourself to it real soon.
Real goodness from Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Get ready for some more good old radio now as we take a trip back to January 12th of 1945. And this is an Amos and Andy broadcast. Freeman Gosden and Charles Corral, radio's all-time favorites, now on the air at this time for NBC. Their sponsor was Rinso. And this half-hour show really provides a lot of good fun for us. Amos and Andy from January 12th of 1945.
Say, Andy, did you hear that? Come on.
Did I hear what?
That whistle. That's the Rinso White whistle.
And Rinso means us.
That's right. Rinso gets clothes Rinso White. And Rinso presents the Amos and Andy Show. You know, I always maintain if you begin right, you'll end right. Take wash day, for instance. If you begin it right by whistling while you wash, you'll end it right with a wash that's snowy, Rinso White. You see, Rinso's soapy-rich suds get out more dirt, so you just pop your clothes into those swell suds and let them soak for as little as 10 minutes. Then a few light rubs on the stubborn places and rinse. Result, a wash that's really clean. Washable colors gay and Rinso bright. Safely, after dozens of washings. And what a whitewash Rinso turns out. Sheets and shirts and table linens, dazzling Rinso White. So ladies, make next wash day a Rinso wash day. And whistle while you wash. And now, our stars, Amos and Andy. After waiting 2 years for the second payment on the Kingfish's personal desk at the Lodge Hall, the finance company gave up hope and took back the desk. That's why we now find the Kingfish in a second-hand furniture store about to buy a desk he can afford. At the moment, he's being convinced by the salesman that a rickety old desk he's looking at is a genuine antique.
Now, look here, Mr. Miller. I ain't complaining because the desk is all bruised up and ready to fall apart, but... ain't you got none without them little holes in it?
Oh, those little holes. Well, those are wormholes. That proves it's a genuine antique.
Is a genuine antique because it got wormholes?
Well, naturally. Of course, there are imitation antiques with man-made wormholes, but those are less expensive.
Less expensive? You mean the men's work cheaper than the worm?
No, what I meant to say was the wormhole stamped this as being an authentic antique. As a matter of fact... this desk actually belonged to George Washington.
Oh, George Washington, huh? Yeah, this must be the one he throwed across the Potomac. You want $6 for the thing, huh?
Stevens, how can you quibble about $6? Remember, this is the desk that the father of our country actually wrote letters on.
Yeah, from the looks of the thing, I guess he rid him with his little hatchet there, too, didn't he? Tell you what, Miss Muller, I'll take it. I'll give you $4 now, and you send the desk over to my office at the Lodge Hall, and I'll raise the other $2 before 6 o'clock.
All right, Stevens. It's a deal.
I can't tell you how sweet it was of you to come over and bring us this anniversary present.
Oh, that's all right, Sapphire. You and the Kingfish is two of our closest friends. Tell me, what did the Kingfish give you for your anniversary?
I wish you hadn't asked me that, Amos. George walked out of the house this morning, and he not only didn't give me a remembrance, he didn't even mention our anniversary. I feel terrible.
Well, now, look, Sapphire, maybe he did that on purpose, you know, so he could kind of surprise you tonight with a present.
No, Amos. He just forgot about it. It's because it don't mean nothing to him no more. Amos, the love has been went out of our marriage.
Oh, don't say that, Sapphire. The Kingfish still loves you. I know he does.
Well, not like he used to, Amos. I just took out some old love letters that he wrote me 20 years ago, just before our marriage. Here, read this one. It's short, but it certainly is beautiful. It comes with some flowers.
To the most wonderful woman who ever drew the breath of life, I love you with all my heart, George. Yes, Sapphire, that's really beautiful, all right.
Yes, ain't it? I was looking over these other four letters, too. They're all just the same, sweet and affectionate. Oh, Amos, why can't George be sweet like that again?
Yeah, well, what we got to do is kind of remind him, say, wait a minute, I got an idea. I tell you what I'll do, Sapphire. I'll take these five letters, and I'll slip them into Kingfish's desk at the office, and when he find them, it's going to remind him of the way he used to feel about you, see? Sapphire, I know this is going to work. Well, look at that, Anna. They must have delivered my new desk while we was out to lunch.
Oh, that's a new desk?
Yeah.
Well, if that was a new desk when you bought it, we must have took longer to eat lunch than we thunk. Look at all them holes. Look at them holes in there. What is them?
Oh, them is wormholes, Andy. Yeah, that proves the thing was owned by George Washington. Yeah, there used to be worms in that desk.
Yeah, that's a fine thing for a fellow to keep in the desk. Boy, this thing sure is busted down. Look at this drawer here.
Mm-hmm.
What are these papers doing in here? They look like old letters.
Yeah, let me see them there, Andy. Yeah, five of them.
That's right.
Yeah, one say to the most wonderful woman who ever drew the breath of life, I love you with all my heart, signed George. Say, Andy, this letter signed George.
Signed George, huh? Well, what about it? George is a common name. Even you has got it.
Say, Andy, don't you understand? This just belonged to George Washington. And if these letters are signed George, then these letters must have been written by the father of our country.
Yeah. To the mama of our country.
Yeah. Oh, say, Andy, this is the greatest thing that's ever done happen to me.
Yeah, it's good, all right, but
Listen, Andy, don't you understand? If these are George Washington's letters, they are worth a fortune. Oh, people collect this kind of stuff, and they pay anything for them, maybe even
$10,000. $10,000? Well, this has certainly been our lucky day, ain't it, partner dear?
Yeah, well, I thought... Hey, Andy, that was a word you done used there that kind of grated up against me there, you know it? The word partner. Now, that word only is used when there's two or more peoples in a deal. And there's just one people in this deal, and I is both of them. That's what it is.
Now, just a second, King.
Now, just a second, nothing. Them letters is mine. That's my desk. Picked it out myself, and I bought it with my own money.
Yeah, that's right. You put up the capital, and I has done put up the labor.
What labor?
I was the one that opened the drawer.
Nothing doing, Andy. No partners.
But Kingfish, I as your friend.
But I tell you, I ain't taking no partner in this deal.
But we has been partners in dozens of deals.
Sorry, son, the answer is definitely no.
I'll give you $12.
Here's your receipt. Now, look here. Now I can pay the rest that I owe on the desk with this money of yours.
Yeah, well, here's your money.
Yeah, thanks, Andy. Lightning's out in the hall there. Call him there, will you, Andy?
Okay.
Hey, Lightning.
You on me, Miss Andy?
Yeah, you ain't busy, is you?
Well, I just been sweeping up the hall again.
Yeah, well, the Kingfish want to see you in here.
Brother Kingfish, I ain't got much time. What I got to do is go to my memory course at night school.
Well, I don't care nothing about that, Lightning. Now, look, Lightning, this is reporting. I want you to take this $2 over to Miller's Secondhand Furniture Store and pay it to him for me. Now, whatever you do, Legend, get this in your head.
Yeah, Alpha?
I want you to get a receipt.
Okay, Kingfish.
Yeah, that's right. That receipt is reporting, Lightning. You see, we done kind of struck it big here. We got some letters that George Washington done writ.
Did you say George Washington done writ them?
Yeah,
that's right, Lightning. He writ them over 100 years ago down in Virginia. And today, just come into our hands.
That a mail sure is slow, ain't it?
Listen, Lightning, they didn't come in the mail.
You say they didn't come by the mail?
No. We done found them in this genuine George Washington desk that the Kingfish bought at Miller's. These letters might be worth $10,000.
Yeah, and that's why you pay us, when you pay us the money now, give the man $2, you got to be sure and get a receipt proving that the desk is mine. Now get going.
Okay, Brother Kingfish. I'll whiz over there.
All right now, Kingfish. Where do we take these letters and get the money for them?
Well, now, look here. I'm just thinking here, and I've been thinking, and something done hit me in the head here, right smack in my brain.
Yeah, go ahead. Let's
now, look here. We might take them down to the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., you know, District of Columbia. Take them right down there, of course. They collect all that historic stuff.
Yeah, but do you think they're going to be crazy enough to pay $10,000 for five old letters?
Oh, sure. They ain't so smart about the things they buy.
Damn.
Oh, they buy his old broken-down spinning wheel. Yeah, they even bought the first plane the Wright brothers ever built. And that was a bad thing to buy.
Was, huh?
Yeah, since they bought it, ain't nobody down there ever see them fly it. I don't know what they want with the thing.
Well, then that might be the... Wait a minute.
Oh, good morning, boys. Good morning. Glad to see you.
Yeah, come in, Gabby.
Yeah, how are you, Gabby?
I just met Lightning. Just met him out in the hall. He told me all about the Washington letters, all about them letters. Valuable property. Yes, indeed, valuable property. Let me see a couple of them.
Valuable property, huh? Here you is, Gabby. Look at them.
Yeah. He sure was crazy about Martha, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah, he was fixing it all right.
These are old letters, all right. Must have been written with a quill.
A quill?
Oh, yeah, and that's where they used to do it in the old days. They used to write with the tail feathers of a chicken.
They did, huh? Didn't the chicken get in the way?
Oh, Andy. They plucked out the feathers first.
Oh, they pulled the... Oh, I see.
Now, look here, Gabby. Me and Andy is sticking on getting $10,000 for these letters.
$10,000? Ooh, goodness, that's a lot of money. Yes, indeed, a lot of money.
Yeah, and when we get it, we each going to take our share and put it right smack in the bank, too.
Is that what you're going to do? Is that what you're going to do with $10,000? In financial circles, that's what they call sinking fund.
Sinking fund? How you figure?
Well, if you start sinking that money in the bank, you ain't going to have much fun. That's sinking fun if I be at it.
Now, look here, Gabby. You might be able to help us on selling these letters. Now, we were thinking that we might take them down to the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. Now, what you think?
Bad. Very bad, Kingfish. You don't stand a chance there. No, indeed, not a chance. What you ought to do is take them to this fellow, Professor Pepperdine, I don't read about. Professor Pepperdine. He's a famous collector of everything of the colonial period. I can get his address for you.
Professor Pepperdine. Yeah, well, now, that sounds like a good idea. I'll go down there to see him.
Yeah, Kingfish, do that. Well, Gabby, I guess this whole thing make me and the Kingfish about the smartest men in Harlem, don't it?
Andy, I'd rather not answer that, if you don't mind.
Why not?
I was like George Washington. I can't tell a lie neither.
$2 for the desk, Miss Miller.
Yes. Thanks. And here's Stephen's receipt. Oh, say, before you go, would you mind telling me about those George Washington letters again?
Yeah, well, all I know is that the Kingfish signed them letters in the desk he done bought from you, and they worth $10,000.
Yes, well, that's fine. Yes, thanks.
Well, goodbye.
So that broken-down piece of junk really was a George Washington desk. Well, I'm going over and buy that back from Stevens before this day's over.
Hello,
Come in, Amos, come in.
Well, hi there, Ender. Say, where's the Kingfish?
Oh, he gone down to see a fella by the name of Professor Pepperdine. He gonna sell him something.
Yeah.
I'm glad you dropped in, though, Amos. I got big news to tell you. Me and the Kingfish done discovered something.
Wait a minute. Oh, that Kingfish, Andy, he makes me mad. Somebody ought to give him a good talking to, you know it?
What's the matter?
Well, today is Sapphire's and his 20th wedding anniversary, and he done clean forgot about it. Sapphire's all broke up, she crying and everything else.
Oh, well, believe me, Amos, the Kingfish got a good excuse for having to slip his mind today.
Oh, no, he ain't neither. Now, I tell you what, me and Sapphire done figured out a way to kind of jog his memory and remind him of the way he used to feel about her. And we done it, you see, but he didn't pay no attention to it.
Didn't.
Well, I tell you what, you see, I put 5 old love letters that he writ to her 20 years ago in that old desk that he bought for the office.
Yeah, well, the big news that I'm going to, Amos, did I hear you say something about putting 5 letters in the Kingfisher's desk?
Yeah, that's right, Andy, yeah. But it didn't do no good. Tell me, Andy, what was the big news that you was going to tell me?
It just got smaller. Oh, me. Why don't nothing ever work out right? It seemed like my castles always come crumbling down. Amos, would you mind leaving me alone? I got some heavy figuring to do.
Oh, sure, Andy. What is it you got to figure out?
How I was going to get $12 back.
But Professor Pepperdine, I can't understand it. Is you sure these letters wasn't writ by George Washington?
Not only that, but the original contents of these letters weren't written more than 20 years ago.
No.
My advice to you, Stevens, is not to even attempt to sell them as George Washington letters, or you'll end up in jail.
Yeah, well, I sure like to get my hands on the big bum that writ these letters in the first place. Well, thanks anyway, Professor. So long.
Goodbye.
Well, there's only one thing to do. I got to get a hold of Andy and sell him my half of the partnership for another $12.
Our Metro-Golden-Memory Shop at 5120 West Irving Park Road is ready to serve you with lots of memory minders of the good old days. Hundreds of recordings of old-time radio shows on cassette, 8-track tape, and on LP records. Plus big band, soundtrack, and personality recordings. Lots of new things to bring back the old times. Lots of old things to provide more good times. Movie posters, magazines, books, cards, games, great jigsaw puzzles, gifts, and novelties. It's all there, and it's all waiting for you at our Metro Golden Memory Shop, 5120 West Irving Park Road, just east of Laramie. Pay us a visit real soon, won't you? Our MGM shop is open Tuesday and Wednesday from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m., Thursday, Friday, and Saturday until 8, and on Sunday from 1 to 5. Come in and see all the goodies at Metro Golden Memories, 5120 West Irving Park Road, 2.5 blocks west of Northwest Federal, just across the street from Nelson Hirschberg Ford. Metro Golden Memories, the MGM shop. This is Chuck Shaden with a hall closet full of old-time radio shows every morning here on WXFM 106 on your FM dial.
Andy and the Kingfish seem to have similar thoughts involving a sum of $12. We'll learn who comes out ahead in just a moment. Meantime, ladies, how many personalities do you have? Are you always gay and optimistic, or do you find yourself planning a meal this way?
We'll have fruit cups and chicken pie and candied sweet potatoes and broccoli.
And then suddenly your other self speaks up.
And that means casseroles to wash and saucepans and the big baking dish.
That's a grim prospect, isn't it? But ladies, you can squelch that melancholy other self. Put soapy rich Rinso suds to work on those dishes. Those thick, busy suds get rid of every bit of sticky food and grease in a jiffy. Crusted food particles scoot right off the scene. And before you know it, you'll have a pile of sparkling clean dishes. Everything from casseroles and baking dishes right down to cups and saucers. Clean and bright as a whistle. And when you use Rinso for all your soap and water jobs, your house will shine from cellar to attic. Say, Rinso's easy on your hands, too. So tomorrow, first thing, get Rinso. And now, back to Amos and Andy. Well, now that Professor Pepperdine has convinced the Kingfish that the letters he had were not written by George Washington, and now that Andy knows they actually are the Kingfish's old love letters, both partners are looking for each other in the hope of disposing of his interest in the partnership without tipping off the other. As we join them now, they're getting down to business in the Kingfish's office.
Andy, glad you dropped in, because just sitting here saying to myself, Andy Brown is the best friend I got, and I certainly love him.
Yeah, well, I just come over here to tell you that I was crazy about you, too.
Now, look, Andy, I want to tell you about my love first, and I'd appreciate it if you wouldn't interrupt me.
All right, sorry.
Anyway, I keep saying to myself, Andy Brown is always doing things for me, lends me money when I want it, comforts me in my hour of needs.
Is that me?
Sure as you, yeah. And then I finally ask myself this question. I say, George Stevens, when is you going to do something for Andy? When is you going to pay back that great friendship of this noble, generous, wonderful man?
Is that still me?
That's still you, yes. And the answer come back to me, Andy. Here I got these George Washington letters. Why don't I give them to Andy? I say to myself. Yeah, let him make the $10,000. Of course, Andy, just so I don't embarrass you too much by doing such a great favor for you, I let you pay me a measly $12 for my half interest.
Tell me this, Kingfish. Is you all through with the love stuff now?
Yeah, I think I done covered everything there.
Yeah, because I come over to tell you about how crazy I is about you.
Me?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Tell you the truth, I is willing to sell you back my half of the letters for $12 and let you keep the $10,000.
Sorry, Andy, I love you too much.
Not as much as I does you.
Much more, brother Andy. The love I got for you is greater than all the famous loves in history. Romeo and Juliet, Anthony and Cleopatra, Barnum and Bailey, and all them great people. I tell you, I got them all beat, Andy.
Yeah, well, the only thing is, wait a minute.
Hello, gentlemen.
What you want, Lightning?
I give the furniture man the $2 you give me, Kingfish, and I come to give you the receipt.
Yeah, the receipt, huh? Oh, okay, give it to me.
What's the matter, Lightning? You look like you're dreaming.
I know I had that receipt someplace. I just don't remember where I put it.
Lightning, you don't ever remember nothing.
Yeah, you ought to do something about that memory of yours, Lightning.
Sure. I is, Kingfish. Like I told you, I already done made plans. Starting tonight, I'm going to night school to take a memory course.
A memory course in night school, huh? Well, that's a good idea for you. You need it. You're going to start that tonight, huh?
Aye, yeah, sir. If I don't forget. Well, I guess I got to be going now.
Yeah, well, so long, Lightning.
So long, Lightning.
Now, look, Kingfish, about that $12.
Mm-hmm.
Hold it. Who is this coming in now?
Oh, it looks like Miss Miller, the man that done sold me to death.
Oh, well, hello, Stephen. I'm glad I found you in.
Yeah, you got the $2 I sent you for the desk, didn't you?
Oh, yes. But I want to speak to you about that desk.
What about it?
Yeah, well, you see, there were some other people looking at the desk before you bought it. And when they found out that it was gone, being collectors of antiques and all that, they were very much upset. So I offered to come over and see if you wouldn't feel like selling it for a small profit.
Oh, well, I might be interested. How much you give me for it?
Well,
That ain't enough.
Yeah, double whatever you was thinking and we'll take it.
I'll make it $50.
That's better. It's a deal. That first figure was way too low.
Well, okay, boys. Here's your money, and I'll send my truck over to pick up the desk.
Okay, Mr. Miller, thank you.
Yes, so long, boys.
So long.
Yeah, goodbye.
Oh, boy, that fella sure wanted that desk bad, didn't he?
Yeah.
Andy, look here. Here's the money. Here.
Here's $25 for you, and never say that I wasn't a good partner to you.
Oh, that's great. Thanks a lot, Kingfish. And another thing I was thinking of here, uh-huh. let's forget about them George Washington letters. Maybe it ain't right to try and sell them.
Yeah.
I know I don't want nobody going around trying to sell my letters after I was gone.
Yeah, well, I agree with you, Andy. Now, let's forget about them. Anyway, I got another deal that I can go into right now, and I got $25 capital to go into deal with. I'm going to check on the thing right now. I'll see you later.
This is a true story. One day, the man from Frigidaire walked into Townhouse TV and Appliances and asked owner Mike Moore if he was a good sport. Mike was, he admitted, a very good sport. So, the man from Frigidaire talked him into buying 200 matching Frigidaire washers and dryers in poppy red. Poppy red. Now, Mike Moore at Townhouse is looking for 200 more good sports out there in Radioland. And if you are a good sport, you'll get a good deal from Townhouse TV and Appliances, 7243 Toohey Avenue, just west of Harlem. You can get a deluxe Frigidaire washer and gas dryer for only $498 if you're such a good sport that you can fall in love with poppy red. Now, this very same washer-dryer combination from Frigidaire sells for $100 more in white, gold, green, or copper. That's right. $100 more than the same units in poppy red. So if you're a good sport and a good bargain hunter, and if it doesn't matter what color your new Frigidaire washer-dryer combination is, you can get a good deal from the good sport at Townhouse TV and Appliances, 7243 Toohey Avenue, just west of Harlem. Open Monday, Thursday, and Friday nights till 9, Saturday until 5. This is Chuck Shaden in the Hall Closet on WXFM 106 on your FM dial.
In stereo at 106 from high atop Sears Tower, this is WXFM, Elmwood Park, Chicago.
Hello, Shorty. How is it?
Oh, how is it, Kingfish?
Give me a shave, will you, Shorty? I gotta go out on a big deal.
Okay. You know something? I was looking for you today. Yeah, I wanted to congratulate you and Faf on your 20th wedding anniversary.
Yeah, well, you see, 20th wedding anniversary today. That's right. January the 12th. Oh, me, I done clean forgot about it, Shorty.
Yeah, well, congratulations anyway, Kingfish. I want to tell you, how happy you must be. Married life must be one of the fun, must be wonderful being married to all that. Marriage must be a beautiful, how do you stand it?
You know, I just thinking here, Shorty, Sapphire must be crying her eyes out, of course. I didn't say nothing about it this morning.
Mm.
Maybe I better take a nice present when I goes home tonight for our 20th anniversary.
You better if you expect to have a 21st.
Yeah, well now, here goes my $25 and the big deal.
Mm.
I wonder what I can get her for a present. That first store down the street got a muskrat fur coat in the window for $25.
Yeah, I see that.
Wait a minute. Maybe I might get a better idea. Let me see. The 50th anniversary is gold. The 25th is silver. The 15th is crystal. I wonder what the 20th is.
Well, I know it ain't muskrat.
Yeah, well, I think I'll get her that coat anyway. Oh, yeah, I know she's been looking at it.
Yeah, I was looking at it, too. It's nice, Kingfish, but are you sure it's brand new?
Oh, of course it's brand new, Shorty. Ain't no person ever wore it before.
Well, then all I got to say is that muskrat must have led a hard life.
Oh, now, wait a minute. Don't talk silly, Shorty. Now, the next thing I got to do is write Sapphire a sweet loving note that I can put in with the coat.
Mm-hmm.
You got any ideas on what I can write her, Shorty?
Oh, why, sure. Just say, to the prettiest girl in the world, no, to the most gorgeous, to the lovely, to the shapely of, I'd like to meet her.
Hey, now, wait a minute. I know exactly what to do. I is going to copy one of the love letters I done found in the desk. Mm. Put that in the fur coat and bring it right home to Sapphire. Mm. Here, listen to this letter here. Here's what, yeah, listen. Mm. To the most wonderful woman that ever drew the breath of life, I love you. How did that sound?
Oh, no, that's too short. It don't express the real thing. It ain't got enough sentiment. It's beautiful.
Sapphire, honey, you is just the prettiest woman I done ever seen in that new fur coat.
Oh, George, I've wanted a fur coat like this for 10 years. But that ain't what means the most to me.
Mm-hmm.
When you come down to breakfast this morning, darling, you looked at me as if, well, as if this day was no different to no other day. You can laugh now, but honest, I could have cried, George. Then after you left, I did cry. But now, sweetheart, now I know that you didn't forget.
Honey, if you will just reach in the pocket of the fur coat there, you will see just how much you mean to me.
The pocket? Why, George, it's a note to the most wonderful woman who ever drew the breath of life. I love you. Oh, George. This note means more to me than anything.
Yeah, I thought you'd like it, honey. That's why when I was overcome with the original idea a while ago, the note, you know, just come to me a little while ago, I just couldn't wait to sit down and write it.
Wait a minute, George. You didn't just write that note.
I didn't?
No. That was written many years ago by a much younger man than you.
It was?
Yes. And I'm in love with the man that first wrote the note.
You what? That was a fine thing to tell me on our anniversary. Now, how long has this been going on, and who is the big bum? That's what I want to know. Now, wait a minute, sir.
Well, George, I've been in love with that man for 20 years.
20 years? Right from the kickoff, huh? Does you mean to tell me that our whole married life has been nothing but an infernal triangle?
Oh, darling, don't be silly. What's happened to your memory?
My memory?
Why, that's the first letter you ever wrote to me, the first love letter, when you was courting me 20 years ago.
I wrote that letter?
Why, yes, dear. I had Amos put it and a few of the others in your desk drawer today.
Mm-hmm. Where's my hat?
George, where are you going?
I go into night school with Lightning.
Amos and Andy will be back in just a moment. You can't blame us for puffing out our chest a little over the fact that the makers of 33 leading washing machines recommend Rinso for top results. Take a tip from the experts, and next wash day, team Rinso with your washer. As little as a 5-minute run per load will get you a wash that's Rinso bright and Rinso white. Yes, you'll whistle while you wash, like this.
Rinso white, happy little wash day song. Rinso white, dirty thing it all day long. Your clothes are so white and the color so bright, you'll sing as you work along. Rinso white, happy little wash day song.
And now here are Amos and Andy.
Kingfish, how did you come out with your memory course at night school?
Not so good. Sorry I went.
Why?
When I left there, I forgot my overcoat.
Be sure to be with us again next Friday evening at this same time when the makers of Rinso will again present the Amos and Andy Show. This program is broadcast to our armed forces everywhere. Before we say goodnight,
Is there a lady in the audience who could use a couple of extra red ration points? Well, you don't have to answer that question. But it's easy enough to get those extra points, ladies. Just save all your used kitchen fats, and whenever you get a pound, rush it right down to your butcher. He'll pay you 4 cents plus 2 red ration points for every pound you turn in. This is Harlow Wilcox saying goodnight to all of you from all of us. It's only human to perspire.
From January 12, 1945, this is Chuck Shaden here in the Hall Closet on WXFM 106 on your FM dial. Good old radio show with Freeman Gosden and Charles Correll. We'll be beginning our listen-in to the career of Glenn Miller in just a little bit. I want to remind you about what's coming up tomorrow morning in the Hall Closet. Wednesday, we'll have a Count Basie remote from the Savoy Ballroom in New York City on June 30th of 1937. Then we're going to have the first in a sequence of People Are Funny programs dealing with the search for the Cinderella Girl. Art Linkletter coming up, a program tomorrow from January 24th of 1950. And then we'll also have a Life of Riley show from 1947. Thursday morning, Charlie McCarthy, Milton Berle, and the Glenn Miller story. And Friday of this week, the Jack Benny program, the Danny Kaye show, and Bud Abbott and Lou Costello. Wow, Friday is going to be a 1-2-3 punch of great comedy. So I hope you'll join us and stick with us every day, Monday through Friday, from 7 until 9, right here with our Hall Closet on WXFM 106 on your FM dial. Stick around, we'll be right back. Our cassette tape of the month features two exciting mystery thrillers for you for this month of February. Bela Lugosi stars in an exciting suspense drama from 1943 called The Doctor Prescribed Death. And Peter Lorre appears in the 1947 Mystery in the Air broadcast of Edgar Allan Poe's classic The Black Cat. Two exciting mystery dramas this month on a single hour-long cassette tape. Only $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. Lugosi plays a psychologist who tries to transfer suicide to murder, and Peter Lorre is driven to madness and murder by the evils of drink. It's an hour of great thrills and chills on our February cassette tape of the month. $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. Or you can pick up your February tape at any of the five offices of Northwest Federal Savings, or when you visit our Metro Golden Memory Shop at 5120 West Irving Park Road. Bela Lugosi starring in The Doctor Prescribed Death on Suspense. Peter Lorre appearing in Edgar Allan Poe's The Black Cat on Mystery in the Air. $5 from the Hall Closet, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. It's our cassette tape of the month for February.
In stereo at 106 from high atop Sears Tower, this is WXFM, Elmwood Park, Chicago. If you're a contractor, builder, or one of the vast general public, and you're looking for the best source of supply for any item of lumber, millwork, insulation, wall paneling, roofing materials, or oak, maple, and fir flooring, you want to buy the highest quality at the lowest possible prices. You want a wide selection from which to choose, and you want courteous service and prompt delivery. Miller Brothers Lumber Company, one of Chicago's leading lumber companies since 1928, is the place. Find out for yourself. The next time you're in need of lumber products or other building materials, visit them. Miller Brothers Lumber Yard and Warehouse, 4918 West Lawrence Avenue. For prompt city and suburban delivery, telephone Avenue 33460. Miller Brothers Lumber Company, 4918 West Lawrence Avenue. Telephone Avenue 33460.
Today we begin a sequence of Glenn Miller stories. This is from 1958. It's an 18-part series of programs. We've presented it once before in our Hall Closet here on WXFM in the 9 to 10 segment, and we did them one a week on, I believe, Monday mornings. Well, now we have these 18 shows, and we're going to present them every Tuesday and Thursday morning here at about this time in the Hall Closet on WXFM. It's going to take us 9 weeks to roll through this, but I think you will really enjoy this look back at the career of Glenn Miller. Andy Mansfield is the narrator from a 1958 Armed Forces radio broadcast. Lots of interesting information, lots of great music, as we tune in now to the first portion of the Glenn Miller story.
December 14th, 1944, Air Force Major Glenn Miller took off from a foggy London airport to keep a Christmas date promise he had made to American soldiers stationed in France. It was a flight from which Glenn Miller never returned. Just before the takeoff, as Glenn was saying goodbye to Lieutenant Don Haynes, his manager and friend who had followed him into the service, Lieutenant Colonel Norman Bassell, who was to accompany him on the flight, called out, "Come on, Major, you can't live forever." Today, however, it seems that Colonel Bassell was wrong. Glenn Miller will live forever through his music. Philharmonia Orchestra, directed by Heinrich Halster, playing Moonlight Serenade, the familiar theme of Glenn Miller, recording done in Germany. Well, my proof of Glenn Miller's continuing popularity began just about 2 months ago when I asked our servicemen and women overseas whose records they would like to hear on America's popular music. Last week, I got the answer. As a matter of fact, over 600 of them. Airmail letters from service men and women stationed in every part of the globe. As you may have guessed by now, nearly three-fourths asked for Glenn Miller. Alton Glenn Miller was born March 1st, 1904, in Clarinda, Iowa. The family moved to North Platte, Nebraska in 1909, and then to Grant City, Missouri in 1916. Where Jack Mosbarger, a local bandleader, gave Glenn his first trombone. In 1920, the Miller family moved to Fort Morgan, Colorado, where Glenn attended high school and played in the local concert band. This was his first appearance on records, December 9th, 1926, when, with Ben Pollock's Californians, Glenn Miller played When I First Met Mary.
Old and gray, I just live my own.
Same Chicago session on December 9th, 1926, also produced another waxing for RCA Victor. The tune, "Deed I Do," featuring drummer maestro Ben Pollock singing the vocal chorus. Thank you.
lover. Don't we, baby? Honey, baby, gee, I do.
Do you love me, baby?
Sure, I love him, baby. Precious baby, deed I do.
In order to talk to Ben Pollock about Glenn Miller, we took our tape recorder out to his own eating spot on the Sunset Strip in West Hollywood. Ben Pollock's Restaurant. Great gathering spot at night for musicians out there and everybody who has good memories about jazz. You know, Ben was one of the top white pioneers of jazz, and he still does a classy paradiddle on the drums on Friday and Saturday nights out there with his band right at this spot. It's just about intermission now, and so let's say hello to Ben Pollock. Hi, Ben.
Hey, how are you?
Well, gee, Ben, you've been around here quite a long time, haven't you? Since the early days of jazz.
A couple of years.
How far back do the New Orleans Rhythm Kings go?
Oh, the New Orleans Rhythm Kings, I joined them way back in 1921.
21?
In Chicago, yeah.
Was that the same as the Friars Society?
That's the same band, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Except for the drummer, and that was me.
Uh-huh. 21. Well, now let's see. Then what did you do? How'd you happen to come out to the coast?
Well, a couple of the kids from Northwestern University, musicians that used to go to school there, came down to the Friars Inn and said they were going to California.
Yeah.
And they had an offer out here, and I said, boy, that's one place I'd like to go to. They said, you really mean it? I said, sure, I'd love to go. They said, would you really go? I said, yeah. So they wired Herb King out here as an old banjo player out here, and they said they had the drummer from the New Orleans Rhythm Kings, Ben Pollock, who wanted to come out, and he says, boy, bring him out with you. So we came out here to California and went to work the old Sunset Pier down in Venice.
Mm-hmm.
The job lasted 1 week and no pay and everything.
Well, where did you, where and when did you first meet Glenn Miller?
Well, I was told about Glenn Miller. He just got to town from Colorado, and I was told about him playing down here at one of the theaters. I think the old Criterion Theater.
Uh-huh.
The stage band thing had just started.
Uh-huh.
And I was looking for a trombonist who could arrange. In those days, I was looking for musicians that could double on arranging or singing.
Uh-huh.
Or wear funny hats, do comedy.
Yes.
And
good dressers on and off.
Uh-huh. And Glenn came down, and I tried him out, and he played fairly well. He's playing a little like Miff Mole. In those days, Miff was the top boy.
That's right.
And he played a little like Miff, and I sang some jazz to him, which is the way we used to make our arrangements. I had to sing the jazz, and the arrangers would write it down, lead sheet on it, and then write it out for three-part harmony.
Mm-hmm.
And Glenn just wrote like he read a letter. You know, he just sat right down and had it, and this is what I wanted. So
yeah.
He joined the band 1 month before we left out here. They were cutting out the Sunday dancing down in the Venice Ballroom.
Oh, uh-huh. Yeah.
The next Venice to Los Angeles, we had Blue Sunday out here in those days.
Yeah.
And so we had to leave, and we had no job in Chicago, and so I just took a gang along, and we got to Chicago and started around Chicago for about 3 months, got the boys' jobs with other bands, you know, and we got going finally.
Well, now, how old was, would you say Glenn Miller was at that time?
I think Glenn was around 17 or 18 years old.
As young as that?
Oh, well, they were all young kids. Benny Goodman at the time was only about 15.
That's right. Benny was in that same band, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Well, am I right in saying that Glenn's first recordings as a trombonist were made with your band?
Yes, Glenn made our first Victory records were made, I believe, in 1926 in Chicago.
Uh-huh.
And Glenn had arranged one of the numbers, and in those days we made two tunes on a date.
Uh-huh.
And Fudd Livingston and Glenn, I think, worked together on one arrangement, and Wayne Allen, the pianist, worked on the other one.
Uh-huh.
And also played on it.
Uh-huh. Who else was in that band?
In that band, Benny Goodman was in that band, and let's see, Gil Roden, who is now producer of the Eddie Fisher Show, saxophone player, Wayne Allen on piano, and the saxophones, we had Benny Goodman, Gil Roden, and there's a new boy around Chicago, the saxophone player from out here, Fudd, had left the band at the time and joined us later on in Chicago, and we started to record.
Uh-huh.
And in the brass section, Al Harris, who's out at Warner Brothers Studios here, the young up-and-coming hot trumpet player, Harry Greenberg, who's around Chicago yet, and Glenn Miller on trombone. It was a 10-piece band. At that time, I was sitting playing drums myself.
Uh-huh. Well, now, let's see. After you went into New York, let's say Benny played his first time with you in 1926. Then,
Glenn played in 26. Benny had joined.
That's what I mean.
Benny joined the band latter part of 24.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, Well, what happened then in between time? It seems like I remember reading that Glenn later on was also associated with your band 10 years later in 1936.
Well, Glenn always shot an arrangement into me all the time because he knew that we had the right conception of playing the things that he wrote.
Uh-huh.
And in 36, I was playing Atlantic City and I called him. We had a record date. To do in New York, and I called him to make a couple of arrangements for me, so I gave him the instrumentation. We still had only three brass in the band.
Yeah.
So we get up to the record date, and Glenn comes in with the arrangements, and Charlie Spivak, who had been with me previous, comes up with his trumpet so that we have five brass. This was the new sound.
Yes.
They have five brass, so
I should think.
They came in and threw in their services playing those few Brunswick records at that time.
What's your favorite memory of Glenn Miller, Ben?
Well, I have early memories of Glenn and late memories of Glenn. My early memories of Glenn was he was a real great guy. He was a thorough rehearser.
Mm-hmm.
He laid the law down. When he made an arrangement, it had to be played as he wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
And if a guy didn't play it as he wrote it, the next arrangement Glenn made, the guy was left out. And he was very strict and a very loyal guy. He was very loyal. There was never any undercurrent or anything. If he didn't like anybody, he just told them. And he was the right arm of the band. And later on in the years, when he became the great Glenn Miller, he always called me long distance. What did I think of this? And what did I think of that? He always looked at me as dad, you know.
Well, he should.
Years.
He
and
should.
He always asked me what I thought. In fact, before he went into the armed services, I was in Chicago. I had built a band around Chico Marks with the Blackhawk. We were playing there, and Glenn came into the Sherman Hotel. He called me one day to come on up. He wanted to talk to me. And I came up to his apartment. Mrs. Miller, Helen, was there, and there was a lot of Navy brass there. And we excused ourselves into the bathroom there. We talked.
Privately.
Says he had this chance of going into the Navy.
Yeah.
In a pretty big top spot. And what did I think? Right at the peak, you know.
Yeah.
And I says, well, I thought he had time to wait. He says, well, if I wait and get drafted, I'll start at the bottom. I says, I'll never take a guy like you and put you at the bottom. He says, this way I can start right off in a pretty good spot, you know. So I said, why don't you wait this thing out? He says, I'm so tired of these guys dancing by and giving me the big bird, why aren't you in uniform?
Uh-huh.
He says, I just can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
He says, I've got enough money saved. He says, if I come out with my right mind, I'll always have a good band. He says, and I'll be one of the few guys to start, of the bigger bands, to start going into the services, and it'll look good. He says, so
might set an example.
Just what you thought.
In fact, I believe it did set an example for many other well-known band leaders.
And I had left Chicago, and a few months later, he called me and says he was going into the Air Force and had this deal of building all the bands for the Air Force band. And he was already in, and that was it.
Well, that's very, very interesting, Ben. I mean, these... You know, every time there's something about these little chats that I've been having with friends and musicians of Glenn Miller who played with him or whom he played with, and there's always some other side of the man that comes out as I've been talking to these different ones like yourself. Well, Glenn Miller, we were just saying about how his music. Here's the thing. Here's a band which hasn't made a record since before about 1942, which hasn't had a leader, which lost its leader in 44, and yet today the music is as much alive and as much a part of our dance picture and rhythm picture as it ever was.
Well, I think he'll live, musically, I think he'll live forever, just as our old jazz, you know, the way they dig it up, you know.
Yeah.
Glenn will live forever because it's nostalgic. There's melody in there. There's tone quality. Luckily, he came in during the of the good recording age when they made records right.
That's right.
You know,
that's right.
When we made our first record for Jeanette with the New Orleans Rhythm Kings, it was horn recording.
Yeah.
We weren't allowed to use a bass drum so that our relatives or family might hear that we were on the records. We hit a wood block and a cowbell to let them know that we were there.
Yes, you know.
But there's only one thing that I'd like to get in, Andy, is I have only one ambition left musically. And I started to talk about this thing many years ago, but now I think I'm settled down enough and don't have too much to do that I can undertake to start this ball a rolling. I've always felt that I'd like to have a Glenn Miller Memorial Building. Now, this building, which would be gotten together strictly by contributions, we'd like to have a music school for the youngsters. That's probably one of those deals, a half a dollar a lesson, they'd have to go out and earn it.
He would have loved that.
And something where the kid could have a place to come and hear recordings, get personal training, probably develop a 100-piece brass band that would play the Glenn Miller march arrangements.
Yeah.
And we'd have different age groups of playing the Glenn Miller good danceable arrangements.
What a wonderful
idea. A lot of good ideas on what to do in trying to develop one of these memorial things. And I really think that he was entitled to have a good memorial, something going on for him.
Well, who knows, Ben? Perhaps just the utterance of those words right now might be the start of just such a memorial.
Well, I had mentioned it about 48 or 49, and Jimmy Fiddler put it on the air, and he called me, and he says he never had so much mail and so many phone calls on anything that he'd ever said. And I got so busy with my recording business and also my agency at the time, and I wanted the help of some of the band leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ever try to get band leaders together, boy, that's a job. Everybody promised, nobody came. So one of these days, I'm at that age bracket now where I don't have to run too much, and I'm going to do this thing that kills me.
Well, Ben, you've got a mighty fine idea, and let's hope that this does happen. And if any small part that we might have in that way, we'd be only too happy to be a part of that suggestion and that plan.
Well,
thank you, Ben Pollock, for filling us in on Glenn's first recordings. We had to come to the granddaddy of the jazz business here, and you've started many of them on their way. Harry James, Glenn, Benny, and we couldn't remember. We wouldn't have time enough on this program to recount all the top names, jazz names, that went to kindergarten with Ben Pollock's School of Jazz. And a great school it's been, too.
Well, now that you remind me about all the old guys we developed, we're now making pictures of 17 of my ex-boys. They're all going to be oil. And we're putting up on our wall in time. The Pollock Restaurant will be the Field Museum.
Of musicians. Of alumni.
I have hanging now, I have Tommy Dorsey's horn, one of his horns. I've got Big Spiderbeck's horn. Mrs. Miller has Glenn Miller's number two horn waiting for me to have picked up. Benny's going to send me a clarinet. We're going to have a field museum of the old good musicians.
Oh, Ben, that'll just be great. That'll really be something to see. Well, I see some of your cash customers around here are waiting for more of that Pollock brand of good jazz at your own restaurant out there on the Sunset Strip. And so thanks again, Ben Pollock, for this interesting and very informative chat about Glenn Miller.
Thanks a lot, Andy, and have me back again, won't you?
We sure will.
Phil Harris and Alice Faye are on the cover of our Nostalgia Newsletter and Radio Guide for February, and that's just the first of 32 pages of fun and memories that you'll have at your fingertips when you subscribe to our little Nostalgia Guide. A one-year subscription is just $7, and you can subscribe right now when you call us at our brand new number, 943-7474. That's 943-7474. Begin your year of good reading and good entertainment right now. 943-7474. Give us your name and address. We'll begin your subscription with the February issue, which you'll have in just a couple of days, and we'll include an invoice along with that first issue. Page after page of photos and memories from not so long ago, plus the complete listing of our old-time radio broadcast schedule. 943-7474. Now, in our February newsletter, You'll find an article about the making of Rhapsody in Blue, the 1945 screen biography of George Gershwin. Other articles about Inner Sanctum, Leo McCarey, Armed Forces Radio's V-Disc program, Big John and Sparky, and the story of radio in 1942 with a primetime radio log for Chicago on a day in 1942. There's also news of our Memory Club movies, our Dime Store want ad page, letters from readers, and advance news of a gala citywide Riverview Night of Nostalgia coming up this spring. Subscribe now to our Nostalgia newsletter and radio guide. 943-7474. A one-year subscription is only $7. You can start bridging the time gap between yesterday and today when you subscribe today and begin the fun with your February issue. 943-7474. Or send $7 to Nostalgia Newsletter, Box 421, Morton Grove, 60053. But if it's easier, just give us a buzz now or anytime today. 943-7474. This is Chuck Shaden opening our hall closet every day, Monday through Friday, on WXFM 106 on your FM dial.
After 2 years with Ben Pollock, Glenn Miller left the band in 1928 to do freelance arranging and playing in New York. It was here on October 7th, 1928, that he married his college sweetheart, Dorothy Helen Berger. Starting in 1929, Glenn played many recording dates with Red Nichols and his Five Pennies. This was one of the top sellers, recorded July 3rd, 1930, when Glenn Miller played Straight Melody against Jack Teagarden's Jazz Chorus on this Five Pennies version of The Sheik of Araby.
Wait, man, what in the world are you singing about? Don't you know that's all out of date?
Why, who are you?
I'm the Sheik, man, that's who I be. And all the gowns, they fall for me. You loving men from Araby. Ain't Sheik no more, you used to be. You sang a song for years, it seems. But there's better ways to capture queens. I choose this way that fits my means. Here's what won the gals in New Orleans.
Verdict it is.
That was Jack Teagarden along with Glenn Miller on Red Nichols' Five Pennies playing an old recording of The Sheik. And so we come to the end of Chapter 1 of the Glenn Miller story. Our thanks to director Jack Giles and our engineer Wayne Dubois. Until our next program, which will be Chapter 2 of the Glenn Miller story, this is Andy Mansfield saying thanks for listening to America's Popular Music.
Underneath the spreading chestnut tree, I loved him and he loved me. angels sing. The angels sing the sweetest song I ever heard. You speak and the angels sing. Or am I breathing music into every word? Suddenly the setting is strange. I can see water and moonlight beaming, silver waves that break on an undiscovered shore. Then suddenly I see it all change. Long winter nights with the candles gleaming through it all, your face that I adore. You smile and the angels sing. Just a gentle murmur at the stars. We kiss and the angels sing and leave their music ringing in my heart.
And that's the Glenn Miller story, Chapter 1. From 1958, we'll have the next consecutive chapter of this, Chapter 2, which makes a real interesting chronological order, right? Thursday morning, the 3rd of February, right here in the Hall Closet. Chuck Shaden on WXFM 106 on your FM dial. Stick around, we'll be back in a flash.
What do you look for in your new car? Performance, style, selection, comfort, service, a good deal? Well, all of this and more can be yours at Mack Cadillac, 303 West Grand Road in Mount Prospect. Mack has the world's largest display of beautiful new 1977 Cadillacs. Take a test drive and feel the top quality that Cadillac has always stood for. Immediate delivery, no waiting for months. On-the-spot financing and insurance are available, too. Mack Cadillac can lease the car of your choice, too. A luxurious new Coupe de Ville, yours for only $249 a month for 36 months. Call 392-7400 for full details. Why pay more? Find out why Mack Cadillac satisfies more people than any other dealer. Where you buy does make a difference. Stop in any day of the week. Mack Cadillac, 303 West Rand Road in Mount Prospect.
Well, the old clock up on the studio wall says it's time to go for now, but we'll be back again tomorrow, Wednesday, same time, same station, with more sounds of entertainment from the Hall Closet. Tomorrow morning, a Count Basie remote from the Savoy Ballroom in New York City, People Are Funny, and The Life of Riley. This is Chuck Shaden. Thanks for listening.
Join your host, Chuck Shaden, in the Hall Closet Monday through Fridays here on WXFM at 7 o'clock. Mostly sunny, not quite so cold, with highs in the lower 20s today, says the weatherman. Tonight it'll be fair, with lows of 5 to 15. Mostly cloudy Wednesday, a little bit warmer tomorrow. Highs will be in the upper 20s or the low 30s. The extended outlook through Saturday, partly cloudy with moderating temperatures. We'll have highs in the 20s and lows in the teens. It's 7 above zero at Midway and at O'Hare airports right now. That's 14 degrees below zero Celsius. 12 above is the lakefront temperature. That's minus 11 degrees on the Celsius scale. Winds are northwesterly at 8 miles per hour, and the humidity is 65%.
Which would you rather do? Invest $24 billion and get no money back, or invest much less, about $7.5 million, and get several hundred million dollars in return? Pretty obvious, right? Well, last year you did both. In order to help the unemployed poor, $24 billion of your hard-earned tax dollars went for, you guessed it, welfare. But if you're any kind of a business person, you're interested in the other program, the profitable one. That's us, the National Alliance of Businessmen. And we're equally interested in you. We want to work with you to find jobs for the unemployed poor, needy youth, and ex-offenders, and to work with you and educators to help kids qualify for jobs. Because jobs in the private sector reduce welfare payments and create new tax revenue to strengthen our economy. Please call the National Alliance of Businessmen. We're in the white pages of your telephone book. Help America Work, a public service of this station and the Advertising Council.
You're listening to WXFM, Elmwood Park in Chicago, broadcasting from Sears Tower, WXFM, Stereo 106. It's 9 a.m., and it's time to go out to Oak Park. And here's Cliff Johnson.
Thank you very much, Ron Ray. Isn't it a tremendous feeling to know that it's going to be 20 degrees today for a high and tomorrow 25? And doesn't it further exhilarate your frozen mind that the deep freeze may be starting to end? Even 25 degrees, you know, is cold, but just the idea of giving up 16 degrees below zero and moving towards some kind of a thermometer you can live with, the whole thing is really overwhelming, isn't it? But good. It'll be interesting to know the stories of how people endured for the first time. Those of us who have been around a little while have somehow or other been able to slug it out. Like yesterday morning, the night before, about midnight, somebody hollered, "The third floor is flooding in our big 100-year-old house," and I run upstairs, and the water spraying out of the walls and down through the walls, and it's just unbelievable what goes through your mind, and you start turning knobs in a house that old, and you don't know where they are because you've never prepared yourself. That's something that I advise all of you to do. Find out, in case you're alone, where you turn off main water things when it happens, and put tags on them. I had to rattle around for the better part of 15 minutes with the help of knocking on pipes to trace down to where to turn something, and then there weren't any turn-offs, so find the main turn-off. But I know it must be happening to a lot of people who don't have 100-year-old houses like mine. But put tags on all those little knobs you see down in the basement and around everywhere. And this turns off this, and this turns off that, and this is the hot, and this is the cold. But do it. I started to do it yesterday, finally, because it's a tremendous experience. It's not to worry the turn-off water that's flooding your house. This is Cliff Johnson, Oak Park, Illinois, the old American city. And Oak Park Trust and Savings is our good host and sponsor, helping us put it together and in this community, telling the world what we do and also letting the outside world pour in with their ideas and relating to what we have going. We will continue on today in cooperation with Rosary College to discuss what can be done to eliminate the fact that rape in this country is one of the worst crimes and serious crimes in numbers. that we've ever had, and yet because of the very act itself, it is shielded, and people tuck it away in the closets, and they don't talk about it. The actual aftermath of rape, where people don't know what to do with themselves, the shock of it all, has really destroyed marriages and families, and the individual themselves can't psychologically handle it. And once again today, we will be talking with people from Rosary College. The reason we have Rosary College as our anchor, not only because it's part of the Oak Park story in our backyard here, but they have decided to put on a special program that deals with this in the way of lectures and films, if you please, and inviting people to come and come to grips with this in a very candid fashion. I'll see if I can get Dorothy Grundon on the line now from Rosary College. And then I'm...
Rosary College?
Yes, Dorothy Grundon, 342, please.
Thank you.
I think it's 342, or is it?
Dorothy Grundon, continuing education.
Yeah, Dorothy, this is Cliff Johnson.
Good morning, Cliff.
Yes, I just got on the air and I said we had floods of phone calls yesterday showing a tremendous interest in the idea of Rosary College setting up a regular program to deal candidly with the crime of rape.
Right.
And on the line coming now, good morning.
Hi, this is Marsha Alpert.
Okay, Marsha Alpert, say good morning to Dorothy Grundon.
Morning, Marsha. Nice talking with you.
Likewise.
Marsha is an authority. She can really give you some good information, Cliff, and to your listeners.
Marsha, we are on 106 FM, which is WXFM, so that you can make a note of that and tell all your people where it is, because it is an open forum line for the community of Oak Park River Forest, and then we invite the outside world to come in and join us and relate. You follow?
Right.
Okay. We started yesterday, and don't leave, Dorothy.
All right.
We started yesterday with the actual astounding billboard that rape is a serious crime that people shield somehow. Yet, here was something. After we finished yesterday, the phone rang, and a person said, well, the rate has decreased. Incidents have decreased. Yet, they find that more and more people are not reporting it. Does this make logic, Marsha?
Well, I have lots of theories why the police department is coming up with the figure that rape has decreased. Part of it is that I believe that a lot of cases are being reclassified, so that when a person comes in and claims that she's been raped, the police will say, well, you know, this isn't such a good case. We'll charge him with battery, which is a misdemeanor. That's one of the reasons. I think another reason is that, at least from my experience at the YWCA, that more and more women are coming in and saying, I feel it's hopeless. There's no point in reporting it. I didn't know him. I can't identify him, and I'm not going to go through the humiliation of going to the police.
That, I think, Marsha, is one of the sensitive keys to this, where there are two things that enter the mind of the victim. One, they can't really identify if it was a dark night, and two, the whole terrible experience of doing it and the fear of it.
Mm-hmm.
Is that part of it?
That is absolutely part of it, and I think that in some ways the media has hurt us more than helped us, because the movies that they portray are horrible, and they